Welcome to the Capital News. I am your host, Alex Caritas. Today is July 22nd, 2019. Thank you so much for joining me. Hope everyone enjoyed their weekend. So a couple things we're going to talk about today. The debt ceiling debacle, although there might be a deal, we're told there's a deal, so we're going to talk about that. And then we're going to go across the pond and talk about some European news because the UK is set to have a new prime minister tomorrow, likely to be former mayor of London, Boris Johnson. So we'll talk about that a little bit. But first, let's get straight to the markets because we are still in the midst of earnings season. The S&P closed up 8.5 points. The Dow gained 18. The NASDAQ gained 58 points, an increase of 0.7%. The Russell 2000, the small cap index, lost 3 points. The Dow Jones Transports gained 0.2%. The New York Stock Exchange was flat for the day. Oil, WTI, is now trading at $56 a barrel. Brent, the international metric, is trading at $63.50. Gold pulled back a little bit, but still above $1,400 an ounce, trading at $1,418 an ounce. Silver is trading at $16.25 an ounce. Still believe both of these precious metals are undervalued, specifically given the environment in which we live. There is a lot of uncertainty. There is a lot of money printing that is taking place. There is a lot of communication, whether it's good communication or poor communication, is basically irrelevant. There is communication, there is signaling by central banks the world over. If they aren't already opening the spigots, they are getting ready to print even more money, to lower interest rates, to embark on further quantitative easing. It's ridiculous. So prepare for it. Be diversified. Precious metals are a way to do so. You can own them outright. You can own gold mining stocks. You can own silver mining stocks. You can own the ETFs. Take a look at these things, diversify yourself, and be prepared. But I still believe both of these are undervalued. Uncle Sam's U.S. 10-year Treasury is yielding 2.043%, and the VIX, the Volatility Index, lost 6% and is now at $13.53. So, as I stated at the top, we are still in the midst of earnings season and will be for quite a while, next few weeks. So, the markets are waiting the news. How are corporations coming out? How are they reporting? Some are beating, some are missing, of course. This is par for the course. That's what always happens. Some beat, some miss. What's forward guidance? Some's lower, some's greater than expected. This is what we expect. This is how it always is. You know, earlier this year, we had the bar set so low, it was very easy for a lot of these corporations to beat the market analysts, their expectations. Why? Because we were coming off such a weak end to 2018 with a 20% bear market, according to Wall Street's definition of a bear market, a decline of 20%. So the hurdle was very low. It's like stepping over a broom that's already just laying there on the ground. Now things, well, we thought maybe things were picking up in the first quarter. We had 3.2% GDP or 3.1% GDP for the first quarter. Well, maybe things are picking up. It's the Trump economy. Everything's fantastic. Now things are sort of halting. What's going on? Although the stock market continues to make record highs. 3.1% GDP. Unemployment rate is still at multi-decade lows. We are told that inflation is virtually non-existent. So from the standpoint of the Federal Reserve, their dual mandate of price stability and full employment are satisfied. They can check both of those boxes, the two boxes that they are mandated to check. So why now would they have to cut interest rates? What's the problem? What's going on? What do they see that we don't see? Or is this all a game? Is it just a hissy fit? Do the addicts on Wall Street just need another fix? Why do they need another fix? It's unbelievable, but this is what we're talking about. So the markets are going to be in this holding pattern unless there's some sort of breakout earnings report from somebody that's to the good or to the bad. We can anticipate the markets are going to be range bound for the next week and a half, because next week, of course, The Federal Reserve is going to have its FOMC, Federal Open Market Committee meeting, which will set interest rates. They will come out. Are they going to cut interest rates? 25 basis points is what markets are anticipating, perhaps 50 basis points. Because remember, folks, the Federal Reserve does not have a meeting in August. So do they want to wait in limbo, or do they want to really prime the press? Do they want to say, okay, we'll make it 50 basis points just to sort of get it there, make it a big oomph, put a big nod out there to Wall Street. Okay, we're taking this seriously. Now you run with this for a little bit, and we'll see what happens out in fall, out in the winter, and then we'll adjust accordingly. We're going to pull back quantitative tightening. What are they going to do? What are they going to say? This is what the markets are waiting for. This is why they are likely to be range-bound. So we're going to pay attention to that closely for the next week. It's a shame that we have to pay so close attention to these idiots around this table that decide the price of capital. That's not free market capitalism. You want to start solving these problems, end the Fed, abolish the income tax. We say it here every day, or nearly every day, because we know what the problems are. Those are the root causes. You want to start solving the problems, you got to get rid of them. So, Boris Johnson over in the UK, an article from Reuters. Boris Johnson set to become the next UK PM as Conservatives announce new leader. Oh boy, this is another circus across the pond. This isn't going anywhere either. Boris Johnson is expected to be elected leader of Britain's governing Conservative Party and the country's next prime minister on Tuesday, tomorrow, tasked with following through on his, quote, do-or-die pledge to deliver Brexit in just over 3 months' time. Where have we heard this before? Didn't Theresa May say this? We were going to leave with a deal, without a deal, and then, of course, all of the backtracking. I mean, this is sort of how we kick-started this podcast all the way back in February. The anticipation, the hope, again, not a great strategy, but nevertheless the hope that the United Kingdom would live up to its name of being a democratic country, that it would adhere to the will of the people who voted already back in 2016 to leave the European Union. No. We set a deadline for the end of March, and that we're not going to do it because it's too complicated, there's too many uncertainties, and maybe we need to vote again, which is a slap in the face to the British people. I mean, you don't like it tough. That's democracy. That's how it works. Then you should have never have put it to a vote. This is about sovereignty. You can go and check out all of those podcasts. I mean, back from February and March and some of April, we talked about it here on a daily basis. So if you're interested on that analysis, go back and check out those podcasts. I stand by them. But I'm not going to run down all of that because we are going to, again, probably witness something very close to what we did a few months ago. We have a new deadline of Brexit, deal or no deal, on Halloween Day, October 31st, which coincidentally is the last day for President of the ECB, the European Central Bank, Mario Draghi. He's leaving. He's not resigning. He's not quitting. Nothing like that. It's the end of his term. And now we're expecting to see the former managing director of the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, Christine Lagarde. She is expected to become the next president of the ECB. We already know her thoughts and takes on negative interest rates. She's all for them. She wants negative interest rates. She doesn't see anything wrong with them. Will negative interest rates come to the United States of America? That is a very interesting question. It is also a very serious question because it has not worked for Europe. And Europe is basically becoming the crazy, lazy uncle that just, he's the crazy uncle. You don't have to worry about him. This is what he does. Just ignore him. You have this. If you listen to some of the pundits and analysts on the financial mainstream media, they're basically totally disregarding Europe. That there are no headwinds, that there are no catalysts lingering right there beneath the surface, right on top of the surface. It's just the crazy uncle. Everybody's used to him. Pay no attention to him. This is ridiculous. People, I mean, because to continue with the crazy uncle having a gallon of gasoline and a whole bunch of matches. And they say, oh, well, you know, it's just, don't worry about him. It's just crazy Uncle Larry. Don't pay any attention to him. He's fine. Meanwhile, he's got the backyard ablaze. That's Europe. This is the catalyst. We talk about Deutsche Bank all the time. Now, that might be too easy. That might be too obvious. Oh, well, that could be a Lehman event. That could be a Bear Stearns event. That could be the catalyst. It most definitely could be. It could be a smaller bank in Italy. It could be a smaller bank in France. It could be a smaller bank in Spain. It could be anywhere. But Europe needs to be a... You have to pay attention. The European Union, collectively, is the largest economy in the world. So you have the European Union slowing down. Nobody disputes this. You have the U.S. economy slowing down. Nobody disputes this, except, of course, the president thinks this is the greatest U.S. economy in history, which it just clearly is not. You have China that is clearly slowing down. Those are the three largest economies in the world. What do you think is going to happen when everybody is interconnected? And to say we're not going to pay attention to Europe anymore, that's ridiculous. That is negligence from these analysts who actually come out and say they're basically to be ignored. Eh, it's all priced in. We know what's going on over there. It's completely ridiculous. Because, mark my words now, when we get down to this next deadline, we'll see if they hold up to it with Brexit, you're going to hear nothing but Brexit uncertainty again. And now, interestingly, you have a think tank out of the UK saying that the United Kingdom is basically in a recession. How's that for you? Is that good news? Is that good headline news? Not at all. Not at all. And it's going to continue. They're projecting 1% growth this year and next. Continuing with Boris Johnson. Johnson and his rival, Foreign Secretary Jeremy Hunt, have spent the last month crisscrossing the country seeking to win over the less than 200,000 Conservative Party members who will choose Britain's new leader. Voting will close on Monday. The result is due to be announced on Tuesday morning. The winner will formally take over as Prime Minister on Wednesday afternoon, succeeding Theresa May, who stepped down over her failure to get Parliament to ratify her Brexit deal. He will inherit a political crisis over Britain's exit from the European Union, currently due to take place on October 31st, as we stated. Johnson must persuade the EU to revive talks on a withdrawal deal that it has been adamant cannot be reopened, or else lead Britain into the economic uncertainty of an unmanaged departure. So not only will the next Prime Minister of the UK have to deal with Brexit, which is front and center, but now the Prime Minister is also going to have to deal with increasing tensions with the Iranians. Because right now, it's the UK and the Iranians going back and forth. And if you understand the history, like I always say, you have to put things in historical context. If you understand the history between the UK and the Iranians, it ain't good. It ain't good at all. A little oil company, Anglo-Iranian Oil, back in the day, turned into British Petroleum, which is now obviously British Petroleum, better known as BP, one of the largest oil companies in the world. And you can imagine the history. You can imagine the virtual slave labor that took place back in the 40s and 50s, which led to the whole crisis with Iran, the overthrow of Mossadegh, the reinstatement of the Shah. I'm not going to go down that rabbit hole right now. We will save that for another time. But I tell you, folks, you have to understand the history of what's going on. A lot of this stuff just doesn't happen. People don't just one day get up out of bed and want to go attack somebody for no reason whatsoever. There's a reason. There's a reason. Are there crazy people who do this stuff? Yeah, there are. That's just something we have to deal with. But most of the time, there's a reason. Somebody has to mess with somebody. Somebody has to take somebody's property. Somebody has to take their oil, their gas, their gold, their silver, their zinc, their lumber, something. Something. And that's what happened here. Understand the history. We will follow up on this, believe you me, because it's very serious, especially if this escalates, which again, we must all hope and pray for peace, that somehow, and primarily from the U.S. side, that Donald Trump can somehow bring the Iranians back to the negotiating table and end this, because we can't afford another war, and it's more important than the money. We don't want one. We don't need one. We should never want it. It's ridiculous. But that's where we are. So the next Prime Minister of the UK, very likely to be, again, Boris Johnson, is going to have his hands full with Brexit, which he better deliver on, or he's going to have to resign. And he's going to have to also deal with the Iranians. So we're going to keep you updated on this as these stories transpire. Things happen overnight. You never know when the next oil tanker is going to be seized. You have to look at this from the perspective of the Iranians. They are under attack. They have economic sanctions placed on them that are crippling their economy and their people. If other countries did that to the United States, we would not tolerate it for a second, nor should we. It can be construed as an act of war. However, the Iranians clearly do not have the firepower to beat the United States of America, especially if we are allied with the UK and other nations. But that might not stop them if they are desperate. That might not stop them politically if their politicians don't want to look weak to the Iranian people and say that they're just going to continuously bow down to the Western powers. So it's like a wounded animal. They can be very dangerous. And this is not Afghanistan. This is not Iraq. This is a bigger country. This is a more prepared military. It's a better trained and equipped military with the Iranian military as opposed to the Iraqis and the Taliban. So this will be costly if we get involved in terms of blood and treasure. So again, let's pray and hope for peace. Now, moving on here to the domestic front, we were talking over the past couple of weeks. Well, hey, this is presumably the greatest economy ever, the Trump economy. Yet, just next door, you have Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin whispering to Congress, hey, wait, we're running out of cash. You guys are going to have to limit to increase the debt limit. Lo and behold, they have. At least that's according to what we're being told today. An article out of Bloomberg, President Donald Trump announced a bipartisan deal to suspend the U.S. debt ceiling and boost spending levels for 2 years. Yay, just what we need. We don't have the money, but let's keep spending. Capping weeks of frenzied negotiations that avert the risk of damaging payments default. So let me get this straight. It's perfectly okay to increase our deficits and thereby our national debt by the tunes of hundreds of billions. And now what reports are saying and what we've been saying all along is going to be trillion-dollar deficits, if not more, especially if the economy slows down, which it will, which it is. It's perfectly okay to increase spending. That's not a problem. But if we miss a payment, all hell is going to break loose. Is this making any sense? I mean, and I'm going to continue with this article because this is just so asinine, it's not even funny. Oh, my goodness. Trump continues on Twitter. This was a real compromise in order to give another big victory to our great military and vets! Exclamation point. Again, always harping on the military, going for the military and the vets. Hey, I'm all for supporting the military and our veterans, particularly our veterans. Talk about it here all the time. It's a great thing that there are charities that exist in this country with the good-hearted people in this country to take care of our veterans. However, they shouldn't exist. Our federal government put them in warfare, in a theater of war. They should take care of them. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. You shouldn't need charity for these people. They risked their lives. They did their duty. It's a great thing that there are charities, but they shouldn't have to exist, if you understand what I'm saying. You're going to send somebody over there to risk life and limb? You should take care of them for the rest of their life, especially if it has something to do with an injury, psychologically, physically, however it may be. To me, that's so simple, it's not even funny. Earlier, Pelosi and Schumer, these two geniuses, said in a joint statement that, quote, today, a bipartisan agreement has been reached that will enhance our national security and invest in middle-class priorities that advance the health, financial security, and well-being of the American people. I can smell the BS from here. Let's just continue to spend $23 trillion. Just keep doing it. The broad agreement finalized after weeks of negotiations between Pelosi and Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin would suspend the debt ceiling until July 31st of 2021, eliminating the risk that the government could miss payments as early as this September. It would also cancel automatic cuts that would help that would have reduced domestic spending by $55 billion and military spending by $71 billion compared with 2019 levels. They can't even cut the increases. There is no cutting whatsoever. These people are sick. This is our money. There's no accountability. $2 trillion has been spent to the Defense Department over the course of these last 3 years. Trillions under the Obama administration. According to President Trump, the military was depleted. So where did all that money go if it was truly depleted? Or is the president lying? I mean, it's one of the two. You don't spend trillions of dollars and have something depleted unless it's completely rampant with fraud and abuse. And if that's the case, you need to open up an investigation on President Obama, his defense secretaries, and anybody else who was in charge, as well as members of Congress. Where's their oversight? Trillions of dollars. This is our money, ladies and gentlemen. This is as much money as they print and is funny money. It's actually your money. You work for this. You're taxed for it. I mean, wake up. Continuing, under the terms of the agreement, the budget cap for discretionary spending will rise to $1.37 trillion in 2020 and $1.375 trillion in 2021, which does not include the programs like Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security that are automatically funded. That's an increase from $1.321 trillion this year. Lastly, to conclude this article, Republicans were pushing for more defense spending and managed to secure $738 billion in 2020, which we talk about here, and $741 billion in 2021, including funds for overseas operations that are not subject to budget caps. Of course, no. It's just Uncle Sam's free credit card. Do what you want with it. Democrats, however, secured $632 billion in 2020 and $635 billion in 2021 for domestic spending. It's fantastic. I don't know what for. Are they talking about the infrastructure, the A1 infrastructure that we don't have here? I mean, those bullet trains that can take you from New York City to Los Angeles in 2 hours, those ones that don't exist? I mean, you're risking life and limb getting on an Amtrak. If they take a turn at 60 miles an hour, you better hold on to your rear end. I mean, this is fantastic. And they are talking about an increase just on the discretionary side of $1.4 trillion in 2020 and in 2021. And that doesn't touch Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid, which Medicare and Medicaid combined is over $1 trillion. Social Security by itself is $1 trillion. Where's Donald Trump? Where is this man and his business acumen? Where's his business plan to cut this spending, to cut this deficit? All of those tax cuts were supposed to increase revenues. Well, if you increased revenues and you're taking billions and billions of dollars from all of these tariffs from the Chinese and everybody else you're taxing tariff, man, then why does Steven Mnuchin come out and say, well, Congress, you need to increase the debt ceiling, otherwise we're going to miss payments? Something's not jiving here, folks. Something's not jiving here at all. So we're talking about endless trillion-dollar deficits, which we talk about here all the time. We're not being fooled by this. We're not being fooled by this at all because we look at the data. This is common sense. This is basic arithmetic. Don't be fooled because you voted for these Republicans or you voted for these Democrats or you voted for this president. I voted for Donald Trump. But that doesn't mean I follow him blindly. There are things I applaud him on all the time. But there are things I criticize him all the time too. That's how it's supposed to be. He works for you. He works for me. Don't give anybody a pass without holding them accountable. You just can't do it. It's your obligation as an American citizen. You follow somebody blindly, you end up with $23 trillion in debt, no end in sight. The president took to Twitter this morning, going after our buddies at the Federal Reserve once again, which he will continue to do because there is a Federal Reserve meeting next week. This is what he does. Before these meetings, he goes full bore against them. It is far more costly for the Federal Reserve to cut deeper if the economy actually does, in the future, turn down. Very inexpensive, in fact productive, to move now. The Fed raised and tightened far too much and too fast. In other words, they missed it big! Exclamation point. Don't miss it again! Exclamation point. So the president, again, going after the Federal Reserve, saying that they tightened too much. He wants them to ease, lower interest rates, also embark on another round of quantitative easing. Is this a threat? Basically saying, don't miss it again. I don't know. What's he going to do? How's he going to overrule them? I want the Federal Reserve to be abolished. I honestly thought when I voted for the president, given his language towards the Federal Reserve, which most people don't even know exists or what it does, but this is, you know, a big issue for me because I pay attention to this stuff. Candidate Trump was talking about how they were fueling the bubble in the economy and the stock market, and that they're a problem, that it was a huge wealth transfer from middle America to the upper echelons of the income brackets. I said, well, maybe this guy does get it. Maybe he understands it. Maybe he really is going to go to Washington, D.C., and drain the swamp or shake things up. Well, for him to now say, well, I'm the president, I'm going to take ownership of this economy and stock market, which is a huge error, by the way, and now I'm going to say to the Federal Reserve, the very institution that I was criticizing, and in my opinion, correctly, is now saying, well, I'm the president, I want the bubble to continue, I've taken ownership of the stock market, I want it to continue to make new highs. So continue to prime the press and inflate this thing. You hear the word inflate this thing, because that's what it is. That's what money printing is. That's what the expansion of the money supply is. It is inflation by definition. Not from fundamentals, not from companies being more innovative, but simply because there's more money and it has to go somewhere. And it's going to Wall Street first. So where do you think they're going to put it? They're going to put it in financial assets, stocks being one of those financial assets. This ain't rocket science, folks. Connect the dots. It's very interesting, however, though, that in this tweet, Thunder Thumbs, President Donald Trump, says, and I'm going to point this out again, if the economy actually does in the future turn down. This is the first time in my recollection that he's ever even hinted that the economy could turn down, that it was even a possibility that it could turn down. Other than him saying before, the only thing that could stop it was a whole host of things that he said during his State of the Union address back in February, which we talk about here all the time. Of course, that's endless wars. That's continuing these investigations against the president and his administration, those types of things. And of course, I think we've added a couple to that list. We've added, obviously, the Federal Reserve, because he goes after them personally, and the China trade talks. So he has some outs, so he can dance, because he's taken ownership of the stock market and the economy. So if it turns down, it's somebody else's fault. It keeps going up, it's his. But the interesting thing is, if the president is trying to box in the Federal Reserve, or if his main goal perhaps still somehow is to end the Federal Reserve, or to really rein in its power and authority, if the Federal Reserve actually does cut interest rates, and somehow that happens to stimulate the economy, and the economy turns up, and the stock market continues to make new highs, then why would the president continue to criticize the Federal Reserve, and where would the appetite be from the American people to abolish and end the Federal Reserve? You get what I'm saying? If the Federal Reserve is listening to the president, and everything is golden, and everything is fantastic, the economy is fine and fantastic, and the stock market is making new high after new high after new high, then why would anybody say, well, then why do we have to get rid of the Federal Reserve? Because the economy's fabulous, and my 401k is through the roof. You get what I'm saying here? So I don't know if the president, what his game is here, but he would have been much better served if he was advised to talk about abolishing the Federal Reserve and educating the people on why that's the case. Would it have been easy? No, it wouldn't have been easy. These people print money for a living. They print it. This is their business. And then they use that money and they go buy assets with it. That's why when you talk about income inequality, you got 1% owning the vast majority of global assets. That's because they print the money and then they go buy real things with it. And then they charge us rent. It's a good system if you're at the top, isn't it? It's a very good system. That's why these people are going to fight tooth and nail. So I'm highly disappointed that the president takes this approach of wanting to continue to inflate this bubble, to continue to say, well, the Europeans have negative interest rates and they're continuing with quantitative easing. New Zealand now is coming out and they're looking to expand their quantitative easing program. The Chinese stimulate all the time. The Japanese stimulate all the time. That's the word. It doesn't mean that's actually what it does. That's just the PR that they're throwing out there. So the president says we're never going to be a socialist nation. A little too late for that, but nevertheless, let's take him for his word. Then why do we need to follow the socialists of Europe, the stagnant policies of 30 years of Japan, and the communist Chinese? Now, if you can explain that one to me, I'd really appreciate it. So send us your comments. We do love hearing from you. This is the Capital News. I am Alex Caritas. Godspeed.